Are pods plastic? By definition, yes. PVA is a synthetic polymer, but it does not create microplastics. There is an enormous amount of research that supports this, and I'll show you my receipts very soon, but here's a quote from Dr. Alan Burton that provides a neat summary of this misconception. Stating PVA in detergents are microplastics ignores basic science and is a very misleading and false narrative. If this news is shocking to you, you may be asking yourself, well, where did I hear this false narrative from?
These are made with plastic.
This thin film that you see wrapping each pot, it's actually plastic.
Our plastic. This is plastic.
Plastic.
But it is. Plastic.
This pot, on the other hand, is wrapped in a plastic film. It's a plastic called PVA, and it's not readily biodegradable.
We'll get to Blue Land's misinformation spree shortly, but let me clarify the burning question of microplastics. PVA doesn't create microplastics because it biodegrades, unlike most other plastics. That means instead of becoming tiny pieces of plastic forever, it breaks down into its original atomic components pretty quickly. All right, so here's our outline of what we're going to be talking about. First, we're going to briefly discuss what PVA is, how it's made, and what it's used for, so we have a baseline. Next, Blue Land's misinformation, because it provides us with a great outline on the research done in this space so far, which is going to help us identify what's real and what isn't. And third, discuss plastics as a whole and how PVA fits into our very serious microplastic pollution and environmental problem. Really fun stuff, I know. Okay, real quick, what is PVA? PVA is polyvinyl alcohol. You make PVA by taking ethylene and acetic acid, which gives you vinyl acetate. And then, through a process called polymerization, you attach vinyl acetate together into a chain. Now we have polyvinyl acetate. We're almost there, so stick with me. The last step is hydrolysis. That replaces some of the vinyl acetate with vinyl alcohol, creating polyvinyl alcohol, PVA. Now that you're an expert in PVA and how it's made, what else can it be used for? To oversimplify the very wide spectrum of PVA, there are two main buckets, water-soluble PVA and insoluble PVA. PVA used for laundry pods is very different from the insoluble PVA used for glue, paper, and the textile industry. PVA for pods is the same stuff used in food, medicine, and is extremely soluble, meaning it dissolves easily. But PVA used for glue is not soluble because you don't want it to be soluble. That would make glue pretty much useless. And that type of PVA can create microplastics, but more about that later. Okay, that's great, but I don't really care about how PVA is made. Why is it not considered a microplastics, and what does PVA break down into? Great question. Basically, microplastics are extremely small pieces of plastic that last forever. They can't be broken down naturally by the environment, and the only hope to remove them from wastewater, for example, is by filtration. Whereas soluble PVA dissolves in water and creates a uniform solution where the polymer chains are fully dispersed. When these polymer chains eventually end up in the environment, where microorganisms are present, such as wastewater treatment plants, or in the soil, PVA undergoes biodegradation. Microorganisms can break down the dissolved PVA into simple compounds like carbon dioxide, water, and biomass. All right, enough about PVA. We're experts now. Let's talk about what the scientific community knows about PVA. And I believe that bringing up Blue Land, which is a green cleaning company focused on sustainable packaging, is a great way to discuss this, as their recent petition to the EPA provides us with a wonderful outline to separate fact from fiction. Again, loads of misinformation is spawned from Blue Land's marketing, so I hope by sifting through it, I can clearly explain what's real and what's been spun into crafty marketing. Our main question is, does PVA cause any type of environmental or human problem? So let's get into it. Before you get all up in arms and say this is a hit piece against Blue Land, I say that Blue Land's mission and goal, which is to get rid of single-use plastic and minimize microplastics in our environment, is fantastic. And I could not be a stronger supporter of it. Any brand selling a cleaning product and attempting to get rid themselves of plastic is a winner in my book. Blue Land, if you're listening, just make your detergent into a powder. The fact that it takes 15 minutes to dissolve your pod in cold water is harming your performance and market share. Powder is great, and it gives people the ability to dose it appropriately without grinding it up. Anyways, I need to focus. I don't want microplastics in my body, in the ocean, in my food, anywhere. And I'm tired of these plastic bottles. I do understand why Blue Land, what's a nice way to say this, would creatively interpret scientific research to spread their messaging, aka sell more products. But what pisses me off is cherry-picking information and twisting it into marketable misinformation that's confused and scared a lot of people with their online presence. They've constantly and incorrectly created marketing material preying on this lack of information. Shame. Shame. So where did this conversation about pods creating microplastics start? Blue Land submitted an initial petition to the EPA in November of 2022, and then slightly altered it and resubmitted it in January of 23. Unfortunately, their petition was rejected in its entirety. But what were their demands? First, recategorize PVA as a safer choice product, from a yes to a no. That would remove this lovely certification on a lot of their competitors' products. Second, ask that manufacturers fund and conduct health and environmental safety testing using independent third-party scientists. This makes a lot of sense, and I'm very down with it. Also kind of surprised this was rejected. I love unbiased third-party testing because I do it all the time. And as we've learned from Boeing, industries cannot self-regulate in our wonderful capitalist society. I'm really thrilled that the Chevron doctrine was overturned. That's sarcasm. Off the bat, pretty reasonable requests to ask the EPA. So what went wrong? I don't think Blue Land expected the EPA to do their homework on the source material in the petition. And boy, did they get picked apart. I'm going to walk you through the important proof from Blue Land and the responses from the EPA. This was Blue Land's two-prong approach. First, show that there is a ton of PVA in our wastewater and it doesn't actually break down, thus proving it's a microplastic. Then, because it is a microplastic, likely in our water supply, show how PVA ends up in our bodies. Blue Land's first piece of evidence is this study that said PVA doesn't actually get broken down, filtered out by wastewater treatment plants, and ends up in the environment. The EPA chewed this up because it isn't based on real data, but it's a model. Essentially, this is just an estimate with no real data backing up their claim. The biggest problem is this opened a fictional door for Blue Land to say, well, now that we've proved it's a microplastics, we can use any research about the negative effects of microplastics to prove our point that PVA is bad. So they moved on to the fact that PVA ends up in our bodies. They used a study called, I'm going to botch this, microspectroscopy detection and characterization of microplastics in human breast milk, which, you guessed it, focused on how microplastics have been identified in breast milk, thus proving that plastic has entered our bodies. Aha, gotcha. Not really. The EPA responded with the following. While these results demonstrate the presence of insoluble microplastics, keyword insoluble, in human tissue, they do not indicate bioaccumulation of water-soluble PVA structures. Basically, this paper said there is microplastics in breast milk. However, none of it is the soluble PVA we're focusing on. All right, strike two, but even if PVA isn't a microplastics or in our body, it's gotta carry pollutants and heavy metals into the environment, right? Unfortunately, Blue Land's petition used the same breast milk source to make this claim. The EPA responded again with the petitioner's concerns over bioaccumulation and transport of other pollutants up the food chain appear to be based on microplastic pollution research with the assumption that PVA will degrade into microplastics. PVA structures used in detergent films in the Safer Choice certified products do not degrade into microplastics. All right, strike three. You're out, Blue Land. There's about a half dozen more of these, but I don't want to bore you. And in my opinion, the points and studies I just talked about are the most important and easiest to understand. But if you want to do your own research, check out the petition. The EPA finished their response with a bit of hope for Blue Land, with a few important statements. The EPA does appreciate the petitioners' concerns, especially related to plastic pollution and microplastics. Past efforts for transparency relevant to the concerns stated by the petitioners are reflected in the Safer Chemical Ingredients list. And the EPA agrees that PVA will be produced in substantial quantities and that there is or may be significant or substantial human exposure due to common use in agriculture, foodstuffs, cleaning, and personal care products. I'm really glad the EPA acknowledged that this could be a future issue, and this is something that's going to be addressed again and again in the future, because this is a relatively new conversation and a possible problem. To quickly summarize the rejection of this petition, Blue Land used a variety of sources for their arguments against soluble PVA, but used very broad information about plastic and applied it to a very specific material, which was their downfall. All right, but what if the EPA is a corrupt government agency and in the pocket of big plastic? Here's what some environmental scientists said about PVA. Environmental issues which recently emerge in the context of microplastics are not relevant for water-soluble PVA polymers. That's from Dr. Watts DeWolf, the founder of REG MSC. Here's another. Research supports that PVA does not negatively impact environmental health when water treatment facilities are available. Water treatment facilities contain the correct microbes to break down the material completely. That's from the Center for Research on Material Safety at Michigan State University. Okay, quotes are cute and all, but what about some real research? First, a Spanish team of chemical and environmental engineers tested the wastewater from laundry and found no evidence of soluble PVA, but they did find PET plastic particles, which are the plastics from synthetic clothes. Okay, but that doesn't mean there isn't PVA in the wastewater, it just means that the dissolved molecules are too small to notice. True, but a separate research team found that 97% of PVA molecules were mineralized or broken down into their atomic components in wastewater treatment plants. Okay, love that, but what about the other 3%? Another research team found that 85% of PVA that ends up in river water is mineralized, again, broken down within the first 80 days. Okay, I think that's enough about PVA and microplastics. Let's talk about the bigger picture, our awful plastic problem. Hopefully these numbers provide some perspective on how PVA fits into all of this. Us humans make 400 million tons of plastic every single year. 8 million tons end up in our waterways. However, PVA is only 0.1% of the total plastic production. To reiterate, this is all of PVA, not just laundry and dish pod PVA. It's really hard to determine the amount of soluble PVA that's created every year. I don't have that number for you. But HDPE plastic, the stuff used for the detergent bottles, makes up 25% of the plastic market. That's 100 million tons. And only 30% of HDPE is recycled. And these can create real microplastics. To keep this short, in my opinion, the real plastic environmental problem in the laundry and cleaning space is the packaging, especially colored bottles, which are much more difficult to recycle and repurpose than white or clear. Shouts out to Blue Land for their cardboard packaging. Blue Land, why you chose to attack PVA and not HDPE is mind-blowing to me. The laundry sheet companies have racked up tens of millions of views by taking this angle. Big swing and a miss, if you ask me. You preyed on the public's lack of knowledge about this and scared them into believing that PVA is this awful, destructive force. I'm disappointed, to say the least, because this damage isn't really correctable. Your information is out there, and I don't see you correcting it anytime soon. To wrap up my manic deep dive into soluble PVA, plastic pollution is obviously a very pressing global issue that demands urgent action. Each one of us has a role to play in combating this crisis. While no change is too small, I don't believe pods deserve the bad reputation they've received. Pods are the highest performing laundry detergent because of the chamber design. It allows for ingredients that usually don't vibe and like each other, like enzymes and surfactants, to be kept separated until cleaning. But by making a lot of noise and advocating for stronger policies, supporting innovative solutions, we can protect our environment, safeguard wildlife, and ensure a healthier future for ourselves and hopefully generations to come. Thank you for hearing me out, and I hope you found this information valuable.